Let's go, girls.
Welcome back to Feminist Cocktail Hour. I'm JC, and today we are celebrating Earth Day by honoring a woman who has dedicated her life to researching and protecting the animals of Africa. She's another famous Jane, none other than primatologist Jane Goodall. We're making a drink in her honor that I'm calling a go with the flow. To make this drink, you are going to need some light rum, some dark rum, some banana simple syrup, some bitters, and some lime juice. While you go wrangle all of that up, I am going to start the story of Jane Goodall. Jane's interest, some might call her obsession with animals, began basically from birth. When she was a child in London, her father actually presented young Jane with a stuffed chimpanzee instead of a stuffed teddy bear. All of Jane's mother's friends thought that this toy might terrify the young child, but in fact, it may have incited her lifelong dream of going to Africa and living amongst the animals. It's true, I know it seems a little crazy, but this very, very specific dream was part of who Jane was from as long as she can remember. She wanted to live amongst the animals like Tarzan, to talk to the animals like Dr. Doolittle. Unfortunately, Jane's family was not well off. They didn't really have the money needed to send her to university where she could get the kind of education that you would normally have if you were going to become a research scientist. Well, after high school, Jane was determined that she was going to make her way to Africa one way or another. She began working as a secretary, spent summers waitressing, doing whatever she had to do to get the money to get herself there. In the late 1950s, when she was in her early 20s, she was able to pay her way to Kenya, where she lived on the farm of a family friend. During her time there, she reached out to a very famous paleoanthropologist named Lewis Leakey. Lewis was looking for someone who could do research in close proximity with chimpanzees. He believed that this kind of research was going to lead us to make discoveries about the origins of man's evolution. He met Jane, and although she had no formal education, he knew immediately that she was the right person for the job. Her unabating love for nature and for animals, her gentle disposition made her a perfect fit. He knew that, among other things, she was going to be able to handle months of isolation in the jungle. I think that right now, we all have a newfound admiration for Jane, am I right? I mean, the woman lived for years in isolation in the jungles of Africa in the 1950s. That means no cell phones and no Netflix, my friends. If that doesn't deserve a drink, I don't know what does. We're gonna start by adding some ice to our shaker. Like 4 or 5 cubes should be fine. And then we are going to add some light rum. I am adding 1 ounce of light rum. I'm adding 1 ounce of a coconut rum, but any light rum will do you just fine. Now, Jane wasn't totally alone while she was in the jungle. In fact, the warden of Gombe National Reserve insisted that she have some kind of companion. So Jane's mother, Van, went along with her. Van was kind of awesome in her own right. I mean, she saw her daughter in the 1940s, right, in England, coming to her saying, I want to move to Africa and study monkeys. And instead of saying, no, girl, go get married. That's what we do. She was like, sure, go be a primatologist. You're gonna have to work hard, but that doesn't matter. It doesn't matter that you're a girl. It doesn't matter that we don't have money. If you are willing to put in the work and embrace every opportunity that comes to you, this dream is going to be yours, and I'm gonna help you get it. And she did. I mean, again, she moved to Tanzania to be Jane's chaperone. This was some serious parental dedication. Interestingly, these same familial bonds that were so important to Jane in supporting her early successes were some of the most interesting findings that Jane had in her initial interactions with the chimpanzees. Now, when Jane arrived to Tanzania, she wasn't like the man in the yellow hat. It wasn't like some curious little chimpanzee just hopped on her shoulders and they were buddies forever. It took her quite some time to gain the trust of the chimpanzees. The first community that Jane tried to approach was a failure. She was never able to get closer than 500 yards to the monkeys, or they would flee. The second community she found, she moved in very slowly. She spent months just watching them with binoculars from a nearby peak. It took her a year before she was able to get within 30 feet of their feeding space. And by the end of 2 years, she had basically become a member of their community, and they would often go to her for bananas. You don't have to go to Jane Goodall for bananas, kids. We got them right here. We got some banana simple syrup. Now, if you have moved out of the banana bread making phase of quarantine, let me invite you to the banana simple syrup making phase. To make the banana simple syrup, you will take a quarter cup of sugar, a quarter cup of water, and then two bananas. Boil it until the sugar dissolves, mash up that banana, and then strain the banana out. I actually used two bananas to give this a really strong banana flavor. I could not be happier with the results. The results of Jane Goodall's findings were met with some resistance. This is in part because she was a woman, and also in part because she was someone who shirked the scientific method. She was interacting with a species in a more personal way than any scientist had really ever done before. For one thing, she named all of her test subjects. She didn't assign them numbers. She observed their individual personalities and gave them names. There was David Graybeard, the first chimpanzee to welcome Jane into their community, Goliath, an alpha male who sort of pushed the other monkeys around, and of course, the namesake of our drink, Flo, an alpha female and a mother who taught Jane a great deal about the way chimpanzees care for their young. Now, Jane herself never really dreamed about having children. She only dreamed about the monkeys. Again, she was very single-focused in her pursuits. So, after Jane's initial findings were published, she was offered more funding for more research from the National Geographic Society, but with the stipulation that they send a photographer with her to document her work. Jane was not initially thrilled about this, but when he got there, you know, he was a boy, she was a girl. Can I make it any more obvious? They fell in love, they got married, and eventually they had a son who they called Grub. Now, don't fault her too much for the name, guys, because she already used all the good ones like Figgin and Humphrey and Frodo on the chimpanzees. Jane's biggest discoveries about the chimpanzees related to the fact that they were much more similar to us than people had previously realized. For example, prior to Jane's research, people believed that only humans made tools. But Jane's observations showed us that the chimpanzees were engaging in object modification, creating tools to do things like extract insects from their homes and eat them. When she had this finding, she sent it to Louis Leakey, her mentor, and Louis said, "Well, now we must either redefine man, redefine tool, or accept that the chimp is human." Like humans, chimpanzees have complex family structures, routines, and grooming rituals. They discipline their children using things like us, like, you know, distracting them with shiny things. Jane came to believe that the chimps were really just like humans, except, you know, nice. But her research eventually showed her that the chimpanzees could be prone to violence too. They would kill smaller primates and eat them. This disproved the long-held belief that chimpanzees were herbivores. They also would kill one another from time to time and engage in cannibalism. There was even a chimpanzee war that Jane observed that lasted for 4 years, from 1974 to 1978, where one tribe of chimpanzees basically obliterated another one over a territory dispute. This indicated that the darkest side of humanity may not be just societal, it may be deeply embedded in our DNA. So we are going to add 1 ounce of dark rum. I'm using a spiced rum, but a darker rum would be fantastic too. Jane feels what essentially separates us from the apes is language, that we have the ability to acquire knowledge, and not just that, but pass it down to our children and their children and their children. So it's our job to be good stewards of the planet and to hand down our knowledge as to how to protect the other creatures who we share it with to our progeny. When she realized that this was the most important thing that she could do for the animals of Africa, Jane decided to move away from her hands-on research and instead dedicate herself fully to the Jane Goodall Institute, which is dedicated to raising awareness about chimpanzees and protecting the animals and their habitat. In the year 1900, there was an estimated 1 million chimpanzees living on the planet. Today, that number has dwindled down to just a third. We are going to add 1/3 of an ounce of lime juice to our cocktail. We are also going to add just a dash of bitters, because I'm sure those chimpanzees are more than just a dash bitter about the fact that we've been destroying their habitat. We're gonna shake it up, not the habitat, just the cocktail. Here we go. And we're gonna strain the cocktail into a rocks glass over ice. My rocks glass has already been rimmed with kind of a sexy mixture. It has ground up coconut, pecans, and salt, so that you get like a little bit of salt when you take that very first taste. When Jane was making her very first trip to Africa, so many people asked her the same kinds of questions. Are you afraid of the chimpanzees? Are you afraid of being attacked? Are you afraid of being lonely, of the isolation of the jungle? But Jane really felt the opposite. For the first time, she really felt home. To this day, Jane, who is now 86 years old, still maintains her cabin in Tanzania. And Grub lives nearby, but she claims she's almost never there. She doesn't stay in one place for more than a few weeks at a time because she dedicates all of her time and all of her energy to traveling the globe and educating people about the animals. When she is in nature with the chimps, she says that she feels at peace. She feels at one. She feels that she is fulfilling her life's purpose to share with the world the extraordinary lives of these species and the truth that we are all in one same great circle of life, all part of one great flow. What better reason to raise our glass on this Earth Day? Let's taste our drink. Oh, it's really nice. I love this. The salty rim with a little bit of coconut is delicious. It's super refreshing. It's got kind of a pina colada beach vibe, but would also be great in the jungle. Very banana-y. David Greybeard would like it. Flo too. I hope that you enjoyed this episode of Feminist Cocktail Hour. I'm going to be back on Friday. I'll have a new lady then, a new libation. Until then, cheers!
Let's go, girls.